what is latent structure analysis? Well, it's a family of statistical models. The idea is that it explains the correlations amongst observed variables, so things that you measure, things that you see. You can look at the correlations among them, the way in which some tend to be high and some tend to be low together, by making assumptions about things you haven't measured. And we can call those things latent variables. In some ways, this talk's a follow-on from one I did a couple of weeks ago about item response theory, which is a type of latent variable model. And what I'm trying to do today is talk about an overarching theory that's sort of come to the fore in sort of applied research areas, only perhaps over the last sort of 5, perhaps 10 years, that integrates a lot of different types of models and if you like, takes the handcuffs off some of the modeling approaches that people might have taken in the past. So, you know, to use an analogy, say 10, 15 years ago, you'd buy yourself a radio and a camera and a phone and a music player, and you'd have all this, like, you know, chunky stuff hanging around you. These days, you look a bit like an idiot when you can get all of that on just one nice little phone. Same way, in the past, there'd be factor analysis, item response analysis, this, that, and the other analysis, latent profile analysis, blah, blah, blah. These days, there's a nice, compact, general family of models that allows you to do all these things together and really integrate them. So that's what latent structure analysis is. So it's a statistical model, and I'm going to be talking about some of the concepts behind this, not too much about the statistics of it, really, just mostly conceptual approach. And then I've got some references at the end where you can go away and find out all the nitty-gritty stuff, and there's training courses and things like that that are available online. As I'm zipping along, if there's anything that's not clear, please do feel free to stop me. I'm going to start at the beginning. It's always a good place to start. So this is my notation for a correlation. You measure two things. Here we've got two things, X and Y. We've measured them, so I'll put them in a little square box. And the idea is that there's a correlation between them, and I've denoted that by a little curly two-headed arrow. Two variables, and that's what we tend to do in science. You just observe things, and we see whether they co-vary. So I'm going to use a few examples. These are true examples. You can check them yourself. So the number of fire engines that attend a fire and the cost of the fire damage. Highly correlated. Your shoe size and your driving skill, very highly correlated. No, honestly. Perhaps more seriously, hormone replacement therapy and a reduction in heart disease and stroke. And that's a negative relationship. So as people who have hormone replacement therapy tend to be observed to have lower risk for heart disease and stroke. So we've got three correlations that I would suggest that you can go out and find for yourself. You don't have to believe me. These things are well observed. But why do they exist? As a sciencey person, you want to know why. Why do these things exist? It's no good just looking at what the world is. We want to know why. So we want to, you know, perhaps be able to change it. Sometimes it could just be random. So if you've got a study, you've measured two things and you find them correlated, that just could be sampling variation. If you did another study, you might find it was not the case. But when you've got things that you've measured repeatedly, you know it's not random if you've got replication. So the obvious thing is to say, well, okay, perhaps there's a causal relationship between these things. Perhaps you've got one of these things, perhaps the X, causes the Y. And that's why we observe that they tend to vary together. So correlation is consistent with causation. It, of course, doesn't imply causation. But, you know, it's a hypothesis we could entertain, the idea that one of these things is causing the other one. So how do we get on? What's the causal interpretation for the three examples we gave earlier? Okay, so firefighters cause fire damage. So the way to, improve, things when it comes to firefighting is send fewer fire engines to fires, reduce the fire damage. Obvious. Big feet perhaps reflect some inherent driving gene. Who knows? No need for a driving test. Save a lot of money. Just measure people's feet. Brilliant. Policy levers, that's what people are interested in. Hormone replacement therapy causes a reduction in heart disease. Give it to everyone. Well, or at least all postmenopausal women. The job's a good one. So that might be the interpretation in these cases for direct causation. But I don't know about you, but some of these don't sound quite right, some of these causal relationships. Some sounds something a bit fishy going on with some of these. What else might be going on in these data? Well, correlation, as well as being consistent with direct causation, is also consistent with the causal effects of another thing, a third variable, that's having an influence on both your X and your Y causally, and therefore making those things correlated. Because when Z changes, it changes both X and Y. And so it looks, if you only measure X and Y, that they're just correlated with one another. But if you could have also observed this third thing, Z, which is causing those two, you'd see, actually, after we take the Z into account, the residual relationship between X and Y completely disappears. So to use the jargon, X and Y would be conditionally independent, no correlation, conditional on Z, on the knowledge that we have about Z. And so what we call Z is a confounder, because it confounds our desire to understand the relationship between X and Y, especially if we haven't measured it in our study. So let's have another look again at our examples. What might be potential confounders for these relationships? No one can think of any potential confounders. Height, very good one, very good one. Any others? Age for the driving one. Very good. How about the fire? Size of the fire, exactly. So we've got size of the fire. Big fires attract lots of people to come by, put it out, loads of damage. And as we've got, height was a good one, age is the better one. Babies, tiny little feet, useless at driving. Adults, reasonably sized feet, and, varying in competence. But there is a big sort of correlation there between that relationship. So age is the confounder. Seems obvious, took a while, scratching heads. More seriously, what might be the confounder here? Well, this was a case that was written up with a famous paper called "Is This the Death of Observational Epidemiology?" And that's my example of a way of expressing socioeconomic status. What was happening was that before trials were done on hormone replacement therapy, there seemed to be this strong correlation, but it turned out it was just that healthier middle-class people who are more able to go and see the doctor and demand that they be given hormone replacement therapy were prescribed it. They were just more likely to be healthy anyway, healthier lifestyles and so on and so forth, than people in different or lower socioeconomic statuses. Actually, sadly, tragically, after accounting for class and lots of other things, hormone replacement therapy actually gives increased risks for heart disease. And so that's an unfortunate case where a confounder wasn't picked up till about 30 years worth of policy intervention being carried out. So serious business when you try to do research, the idea of confounding, that has real measurable effects. What we've looked at there is the idea that a confounder is a nuisance. It's a third variable that we're not very interested in and of itself, because we want to take it away from our understanding of the relationship between X and Y. However, sometimes the third variable is a key variable of interest that perhaps we just haven't happened to measure. Or more generally, it could be that we can't measure this thing directly. We can only get at it indirectly by looking at things that it affects. So we would call this variable a latent variable rather than a confounder in this case. And here I've sort of denoted the idea that we haven't measured it by putting it in a little circle to denote that it's an unmeasured variable. A classic example, probably the classic example of this type of variable, is that of intelligence. So here we've got your brain representing intelligence being this hidden variable you can't get at directly, you can't view it directly. But what you can do is look at how people perform in terms of tests that you believe require intelligence, things like arts and sciences, and you can see that they're likely to be correlated. People who tend to be good at school at one tend to be quite good at the other. There is some differences. But this idea being that we can measure things that people do and look at how well they do them and assume that there's some trait that we haven't measured directly. In this case, the classic example is intelligence. There's some others. So this would be from I'm a market researcher. I've gone away and I want to work out, right, how do I segment my market so that I can apply the right advertising, the right product to the right group of people. So I've got food I'm interested in selling. So I've got a nice plate of traditional home prepared food there, got some nice healthy apples, another fruit, got a sort of burgery snacky sort of meal here, and a nice lollipop. And I ask people which ones they'd like, which ones they'd prefer, so forth. And I might find that there might be some ways in which these things correlate. I've got perhaps, there might be tendencies for some people to prefer sit down sort of meals, like the idea of burgers or plates of food. Other people might prefer sort of snacky foods like an apple or a lollipop. Other people might see differences in way in which they sort of like or dislike natural versus processed foods, things like that. We can't really get at these things directly. It's only through their preferences, as people express their preferences, that we see what the relationships are, how we can account for the correlations amongst the things, so that people who might like plates of food might like apples as well, but also, the idea is that we measure lots of stuff and we get some idea or we make some hypotheses about what are the causal factors that are accounting for these. A more familiar one for some people around here might be political preference. You could ask people If you're really looking just not at an attachment to an organisation, but if you're looking at an ideology, you might say, okay, what do you think about closer integration with Europe? What's your thoughts about trade unionism? How about taxation? What about redistribution of wealth and welfare systems? And you'd perhaps be able to sort of work out that these things, the patterns of correlations amongst opinions on these issues, would perhaps be related to the idea of being left-wing versus right-wing, having some sort of sense of a left-right political spectrum as being, you know, some higher ideology that guides your opinions or, you know, the way that you express your opinions about issues on that. And there, and these things are everywhere. If you can imagine just about anything that people think of, you know, that you can't see directly, could be cast in a sort of latent variable framework. Okay, so there's a few examples. Well, okay, so one important thing that I'm going to talk about is this idea of conditional or local independence. So later on, I'm going to be talking about lots of different types of latent variable models. So far, I haven't committed to any particular type, but what tends to unite them all, or at least is common often between them in the way they're formulated, is how do you recognize one when you found one? So what I talked about earlier was that a starting point for these sort of models is the idea that that you find some stuff that's correlated. So you get some variables, here there's these political issues ones, and these double-headed arrows express the idea that all these things are correlated with one another. And so what we're hoping for is that when we assume the presence of the latent variable, then these correlations should disappear. And this is the situation whereby we've got conditional independence between the indicators conditional upon the latent variables. So if we assume the presence of the latent variables, then these residual correlations should in effect disappear or at least become non-significant. And this is called this local independence condition. And so that's something that we can use that tries to help us understand when we might have got a plausible latent variable account for a set of correlations. So I'll talk about some assumptions behind these sort of models. The whole idea that there's a latent variable out there that we haven't measured that's causing these things that we have is an assumption, a conjecture. The data that we collect may or may not be consistent with this. But what people have done is devise very statistical models that try and test or try and look at how plausible it is that whether a particular latent variable model seems to fit with a certain set of data. Now, the thing I'm going to talk about, well, stress today, is that a key assumption that these latent variable models need to make, because we don't observe these variables, so we've got to make some assumptions about them to try and pin them into a corner to make them testable, is that we've got to make assumptions about the distribution of the latent variable, what type of variable it is. And that's the sort of key idea of latent structure analysis. We're trying to work out what is the structural distribution or form of the latent variable that we're interested in. As I mentioned earlier, the classic model for a latent variable is intelligence. And this was originally formulated, and still almost always formulated now, as a latent, normally distributed variable. And these things are often called factors. Hence, factor analysis is one way that you can get at these things. So if we were to take the whole population of people and plot out what we thought their intelligence score was, say from very low to very high, this model assumes that it would follow, you know, the number of people with various different types of intelligence would follow this normal distribution bell curve, where most people have got sort of average intelligence, some people have got very low, some people have got very high intelligence. So that's one way. That's the original way, if you like, and the more straightforward way from a statistical point of view, because at least the easier maths, for assuming what the distributional form of a latent variable was. Later on, what we now call a latent class, although confusingly, was originally called latent structure analysis, which now I'm using latent structure analysis as a broad term for the whole thing, and these days we would call this sort of thing a latent class, is if we say, right, no, there aren't just a completely continuous a normal distribution of options in the latent variable, but we could also assume that there's just actually groups of people, distinct separate groups of people that we're just going to measure, you know, the number of people that might be left-wing, the number of people that might be right-wing. Here we'd assume that there's two, we'd assume that there's three, there might be, you know, people who are sort of like middle-of-the-road sort of liberal democrat types as well. But this type of analysis does the same thing as the one we had previously. It looks at the correlations amongst these things, but it assumes that we've got this multinomial latent distribution, just chunks of or groups of people. And the goal of the analysis is to try and pocket, take everyone and decide which group they should belong to based upon their pattern of responses. So that's a latent class analysis approach. But it's essentially trying to do the same thing as a factor analysis. It's just made a different distribution assumption about the latent variable. I'm going to have a quick word, because it might come up in questions, about the idea of the distribution of the observed variables. So we're talking about the distribution of the latent variables, which we can't see, so we have to assume. But we're damn sure what the distribution of the observed variables is, because they're the things we're measuring. It's sometimes thought that, for historical reasons, that the distribution of the observed variable dictates what sort of latent structure analysis should be conducted. So the idea is, if I go out and I get some nice, questionnaire responses that I get, I can sum them up and get them out at 0 of 100. I've got nice continuous observed responses. That obviously means I should do a factor analysis where I've got a nice observed latent variable. And if I perhaps get people to just, rate binary items and yes-no sort of questions, I've got discrete observed variables, then that means I must go on and do a latent class analysis, because that's got discrete variables as well. So this is nicely summed up in this sort of diagram here, whereby it might be assumed that you've got, observed continuous measures, therefore I've got to have a continuous latent variable, obviously factor analysis, latent class analysis, discrete with discrete. That's often the way that these things are sold, but it's bunk. It's utter rubbish. Even going back to the sort of 50s, there's models that quickly followed along from those other types of models that generalize. So instead of, here what we've got is we've got exactly the same latent structure for these types of models, but you can certainly well have an assumption of a continuous distribution. So something like intelligence was developed in educational testing, sort of in parallel with the psychologists who were developing factor analysis. And they used to take just questionnaire responses, test responses that would often be just right or wrong. And so they'd have observed, discrete variables, and they would map that on to continuous latent variables. And that's out in response theory that I was talking about 2 weeks ago. There's also this idea of taking continuous measures and mapping them onto groups at the latent level. And this is called latent profile analysis. Although it often gets mislabeled as latent class analysis, because people often assume that anything with a discrete latent variable is a latent class analysis. And, fair enough. But that's the original model back in the 50s. So what I'm going to talk about today is not really to stress. There are issues. Not going to completely suggest that it's irrelevant what the latent distribution is. But there's plenty of methods out there for dealing with whatever type of data you happen to have. And obviously you want to make the correct choice about that fits with your observed variables, and these make assumptions, and you want to make sure you don't violate your assumptions. But I would suggest that the most important thing about latent structure analysis isn't worrying too much about what the observed variable distributions are, because you can see them and you can pick the right model, whichever you fancy. There's loads out there. The important thing is what you've got to do to try and make inferences about the latent structure. That's the hard bit. That's the bit that we're going to want to make inference about. So that's my little rant about observed versus latent distributions. Okay, so if we go back pre-rant, and we've got this idea that, okay, generally speaking, it seems to be that we've got an assumption to make about the latent variable. We can assume that it is a continuous measure, so you can have a little bit of it or a lot of it and anything in between, or we can assume that it comes in chunks and you're either in that group or that group or that group. So what I've got here is, so the idea is you might want to say, well, fundamentally, which do I choose? Which one's better? Surely these things are very, very different. Now, this example here is trying to show you that actually, in some senses, these two approaches aren't fundamentally different from a statistical point of view. So what we've got here is a distribution of two continuous variables, one on the y-axis, one on the x-axis, and each one of these points is someone, so this person's got a middling value of the x-axis and quite a high value of the y-axis. These two are identical. I'm just going to show what the implications statistically are for what a latent factor model would do. So a factor analysis might try and represent the correlation between these two variables, and they are correlated because you can see that the cloud seems to sort of go up
from bottom left to top right. So as you get a higher score on one, you tend to get a higher score on the other. So these things are correlated. And what the assumptions, the latent sort of structure of a latent profile model might make about the same set of data and how it might try and do that. So a latent factor model would assume that there's some hidden scores that we can't see, and this is the sort of best fit regression line. And so people, if we could actually see what the latent variable is, we'd see that people have scores all the way along this line, and there'd be some distribution where there's lots in the middle and fewer at either of these ends. There'd be a sort of continuous correlation between these. If we draw a 95% confidence interval around that, we'd see that, you know, this is the sort of thing that a latent factor model might do. You'd be familiar with that sort of thing if you use regression analysis. What would a latent profile model do? Well, it will assume, say, we've got one factor here. It might make the assumption that you've got actually two groups. And we've sort of drawn in the centroids of the groups here. And that around this, we've got these 95% confidence intervals, whereby if we assume that somebody's in this group and has this value of this group centroid here, then this isn't ellipse anymore, it's circular, which implies you could fit any number of regression lines here. There's no correlation between the points X and Y, assuming, you know, within class, assuming that you've got that value of the latent variable. And there's another class here that's slightly higher, so we've got one with a low value on X and Y, and one with a high value on X and Y. Same assumption, and then the idea would be that within the class, assuming that we know you're in this latent class, and there's no longer any correlation between X and Y, local independence have been preserved within classes. And the interesting thing is that for normally distributed indicators, so the same assumptions that a factor model would make, a latent factor model is indistinguishable. It cannot be distinguished on observed correlations from a latent profile model. So as long as we've got the assumptions that a latent factor model would make and they can hold, then it's up to me. I can just, you know, from a statistical point of view, there's nothing to guide me about which would be a better choice of model. Completely in the theoretical realm about which makes sense theoretically. Having said that, if the indicators are not normally distributed, then you might find that extra factors or classes have to be extracted to try and achieve this idea of conditional independence. So if you're going to sort of, we'll come on to this later, if you're going to use exploratory procedures for sort of trying to work out how many latent bits of structure there should exist to sort of try and make this plausible conditional independence assumption, then you might find that you start extracting too many if you start making violations of your assumptions. But generally speaking, you know, often it is the case that latent structure straightforwardly comes down to a choice. What do you want, you know, how do you conceive of this thing operating at this latent level that you can't see? Sometimes there won't be any statistical way to look at the differences. Sometimes there will, but sometimes there won't. So having thoroughly confused things there, well, you know, what do I use then? If I've got, you know, some analysis, what do I use? Latent factor analysis, latent class analysis? The obvious answer is to use theory to guide the choice. Try and decide what it is you know about your topic area and use that to help you decide what makes a sensible take on the thing you're looking at. I'm going to use an example about acculturation, this idea of people, immigrants, moving into a society and the extent to which they retain some of their old culture from their heritage culture, I should say, from where they've moved from, and whether they adopt the new cultural sort of practices in their receiving culture. So there's this test of a theory done by Schwartz and Zamboanga in 2008. And they tested a theory of acculturation posited by Berry in the 80s and sort of reformulated and so forth. And I think they were looking at a version that came out in 97. And what they did was they wanted to test this idea, this theory, that there are four groups of people. Or there's four approaches that people might take when it comes to migration. So, for instance, if a person moves from their old culture to the new culture and they completely abandon everything that they, you know, their previous identity and take on their new identity, and the idea is that they've discarded their heritage culture, accepted their receiving culture, and you would label this group as assimilated. If people had accepted their receiving culture but also retained some of their heritage culture, he labeled them as integrated. And then people who retained their heritage culture but rejected their receiving culture, not a very happy place to be in, lived these sort of separate separations of lives. And then worst off of all, people who have rejected or discarded their heritage culture but reject the new culture, and he labelled this group marginalised. So there's a nice theory of the sort of ways in which acculturation might operate in a given situation. This was tested by Schwartz and Zamboanga using questionnaire responses by specifying latent profile analysis models. So this is like a latent class analysis, but we've got continuous measures. They sort of had scores on questionnaire items, and they wanted to try and test this model with these four latent classes or four latent profiles. Now, in some ways, this is what I mean by mapping the theory onto what your expectations are. So they had questionnaire responses. Here's 4 out of 32. I know how to speak my native language. I'm informed about current affairs in my native country. I like to eat, and it was conducted in America, I presume you could change that. I like to eat American food. I regularly read an American newspaper. Some of these ones, seem to talk about the idea of retaining your heritage culture. These ones seem to be about the idea of accepting the new culture. The idea is these study was on people who were either first or second generation immigrants to America from somewhere else. So the idea is we can map our groups onto what patterns of questionnaire responses we might expect. So the integrated group, so sort of on average, say yes to everything. Marginalized group should reject everything. They don't like America and they don't care what happened in the home country. And there's patterns that we can fit there. So we've got a theory, and we've got and we can map that, as we did earlier, onto these four sort of latent groups, which we should, believe that should respond in patterns approaching this with some error, and that should produce a good model. So that's a perfectly acceptable way of going about things. Again, just pushing the idea of this sort of sometimes equivalence between classes and factors. Does that theory demand a latent class analysis? Does it say it must have latent classes and it's completely, wrong to consider that there might be some continuous dimension of variation rather than these rigid groups? Well, I would suggest that that theory is also consistent with the idea of just straightforwardly two dimensions of variation. You've got the extent to which you retain or discard your heritage culture, and you've got the extent to which you accept or reject your receiving culture. And so we could formulate that theory, I would suggest, in two ways. Sort of equivalent up to a certain level of assumptions about the distribution of the indicators. We could say there's a latent class variable, acculturation with 4 latent classes, and so we would expect to see a multinomial distribution, which just means that we've got groups and we've got frequencies in those groups, and integrated, assimilated, separated, and marginalized groups. Or we could just assume that we get these questionnaire responses, and perhaps some of them we expect to say, to tell us about your feelings about your heritage culture. Some of them, as we've seen, will tell us about your feelings about your receiving culture, and you'll have more or less of a positive view of either. And so we'll get this nice little distribution of two dimensions. So two continuous latent factors should have a correlation there between them. So I would suggest that Berry's theory admits a dimensional or factorial interpretation as well as a categorical and classes interpretation. And in this case, I would say, take your pick. I would suggest that if somebody did a latent class analysis and then somebody did a factor analysis and then they started fighting about whether it was really groups or really continuum, you'd want to get the people's heads together and bang them a bit. No, it doesn't matter. The theory is consistent. These are just two ways of looking at the theory. And if both of these you'd expect might either fit equally well. Sometimes, and again this will only happen on an analysis of the particular theory, a theory might demand a particular latent structure and not admit another type of latent structure. But that's a theoretical question and not a statistical question, and so there's not a lot in the statistical books that are going to help you decide upon that. It's going to be careful analysis of the theory. So, after I've rant number 2, about the sort of distinction between latent class analysis and factor analysis. Okay, you make your pick. You might decide to do both and compare results. That'd be nice, sensitivity analysis. But you come down to this fundamental question of, okay, well, I've decided I want to do a latent class analysis, but how much structure do I need? How many latent classes do I need?
you know, and that's often one that exercises people doing these sort of analyses. How many factors, how many classes do I need for my group? Well, I would say the simplest way out of this approach is to ask yourself a fundamental question. Am I just churning through my data, seeing what's there? Am I exploring, or am I testing a theory? Have I got, you know, am I putting my data to one side, thinking carefully about my theory, and then going and looking and testing my theory with my data? I would say you're in the blessed position if you're in the latter, and if you're taking a confirmatory approach, and you're prepared, and painful though it may be, to leave your data to one side and decide what it is that your theory has got to say. So in that case, the theory, just like the Berry example, will tell you how many classes or factors and so forth to look for. It should also tell you about the expected nature of those, you know, which questionnaires, which bits of data should map onto this group, which bits of data should map onto that group, which group should have higher scores, which class, you know, which factor should be correlated negatively or positively with another one. Your theory should tell you all these things. And if you haven't, if we haven't got a theory that's good enough to tell us these things, well, that's a bit of a, you know, an indictment of certain, you know, types of social theory which don't get down to levels of detail that they should do. We, you know, theory should tell us about what we expect to see and observations. But that said, once you've got your, you've analysed your theory and you've decided how many, you know, sort of factors and classes and what their structure is, then what you can do is just straightforwardly take your model expected, you take your data, you fit your model to it, and you see whether or not that provides a plausible match to the observed data that you see. And again, there's loads of references and so forth at the end about how you might go about doing this. But this is a nice straightforward approach. You take a model, theory defined, perhaps a model or two, and then you test them against the data. And that's how you decide how many classes you need. That's a nice straightforward approach, I would say. Less straightforward is if you perhaps, it's not always the case, is that if you haven't got a solid theory to guide you, or you know, you don't trust it or something like that, or perhaps you've just got some new data and you're not quite sure what to make of it, although there's always theory involved, you know, the theory that the ideas that led you to collect the data in the first place, for instance, or someone to collect the data in the first place. So either way, you might decide I'm in exploratory or hypothesis generation mode. I'm looking for patterns in the data, and in which case, software these days makes it quite straightforward to use some sort of automatic algorithmic procedure to search through your data, trying to fit various models to try and work out what the optimum model is, usually to get some sort of thing that correlates well with achieving local independence. So this idea of having enough latent structure so that you've got the indicators pretty much uncorrelated with one another. Because it's, you know, some automatic procedure that usually they don't learn very well, and they're vulnerable to particular things. So often, you know, we talked about earlier, they'll be vulnerable to distribution assumptions about the observed variables. So you might find that they'll pick too few or too many, depending upon whether or not you've perhaps violated normality assumptions for factor analysis and so forth. I think these issues are less problematic these days. As I said, there's a wide range of models for different observed variables, but there are issues there, and that's a very good reference for looking at issues about how observed variables distributions might affect what you find using different types of latent structure models. A bigger problem, which is very hard to deal with in a comprehensive way, is the idea of sampling variation. I collect some data and it's a sample, and it might be different if I've collected another sample, and there'll be little pockets of correlation in that data that wouldn't appear in the population model if I could view the population. It wouldn't necessarily appear in another sample if I was to collect them. And so my hungry little algorithm that goes looking for, you know, cancelling out correlations by assuming latent variables might assume that, you know, it doesn't know any difference. It just sees correlations and it decides to fit new factors or new classes and so forth. And so I end up misspecifying the nature of what the latent structure is. Even if I don't misspecify, even if I don't specify incorrectly the number of sort of latent factors, I can still get the structure wrong. So here's a little example. I want to show you. I've got a regular grid of points. So there's 81 points on a regular 9x9 grid. Each point can be filled in or blank, as you see. There's a shape I've driven in there made out of lines. There's some lines drawn on there. And I want you to have a guess how many lines there are. And the idea is there's 25% error in this. So any point that is part of a line, there's a 25% chance that it will be blank, even though it should be a point. But any point that's not part of a line, it's got 25% chance that it will be filled in, even though it should be blank. So this, if you like, is the lines plus a 25% misting of error. Just what you get in real analysis where you've got some true mechanism with some error sprinkled on top. So anyone want to hazard a guess about how many lines there might be behind this cunningly disguised shape? It's not obvious, really, is it? So we'll try and reduce down the error. That's just got 10% error in it. Anyone want to hazard a guess? Two lines. Four, three. Yeah, see, so, you know, they're good guesses.
58.
Four, okay, yeah, this is good stuff. 5% error? Three, good. That's the true version. So four, really. But it's a bit distinct, you know, it might be tempting in a sort of visual perception thing to think, oh, that's just a line with a bit missing. It's not, it's two separate lines. But it's hard to tell what's going on. So say we take the sort of, fairly easy, oh yeah, sorry, there's the four lines. We'll take the 5% error case, which hasn't got too much error in it, and think about what sort of possible, you know, structures we might get. We might, as some, you know, perceptive-eyed people earlier say, okay, well, you know, three lines, that fits pretty good. You might get it right, and you might say there's four lines, but you might not fit them correctly. So even if you do your latent structure analysis, and you say, oh, you know, I've got the right number, or I think I've got the right number of things out, there's no guarantee that you've actually captured the structure that was really in the data. And sometimes, actually, you know, capturing, trying to get a broad brush approach and capturing less of what's there might give you a more honest opinion. Whereas this three-line version is wrong, there are four lines, but it sort of gets the main structure there. It just makes this sort of, you know, link between these two. Whereas this four-line version distorts quite a lot of the main structure that's in there. And again, the trouble is, without any extra data to tell us, we're just in an exploratory mode. We're just fumbling around in the dark, trying to spot which ones these might, which of these might fit. So things like replication and perhaps splitting your sample and doing it twice and seeing you get the same thing are sort of helpful to try and avoid these sort of problems. Time's getting along, so I'm going to completely skip through this idea of model fit, but you know, there are ways in which you can tell whether one model fits better than another. And I'm going to talk about the actually, you know, right, there's about 5 minutes to go. This is actually what I want to talk about. So far, we've just been talking about models. It's probably something you might be familiar with. But earlier, we talked about the idea that you're constrained somewhat by, you've got to choose a model. You've got to say, do I want some latent factors or do I want some latent groups? These days, through a sort of slow and painful unified approach to just, what I can tell, writing down these models using the same notation and avoiding the sort of biases and prejudice that come from sort of certain models coming out of psychology, certain other ones coming out of sociology, and statisticians hating them all because they involve things that you can't see and that's just stupid. There's emerged this sort of generalized framework that says, okay, these are just different ways of representing things we can't see and we can put them together. You don't need to choose whether you want a latent class or a latent factor. You can look at your theory, see what your theory suggests, and then specify a model to fit your theory that might, you know, that might involve a mixture of these things in a flexible way. Latent classes and factors all in the same model. So for instance, you could talk about a mixture distribution. So an assumption of one of these factor analysis models is that you've got normally distributed latent variable. Well, what happens if you take, you know, you've got some expectation that there's going to be some severe non-normality? What you can do is you can take two normally distributed variables, components or mixtures, and add them all together to try and represent, if you like, an arbitrarily complicated distribution that you might expect. Here it's a very simple distribution, but it's sort of showing a weird, skewed sort of distribution there. So I can tell my analysis, go away and find me, you know, fit two. I can either do it exploratory wise, I can say, you tell me where this lump is, or I can tell it, where, you know, go and look for a lump over here if I expect there to be a large group of people with very low values on the latent variable. Say, for instance, here, I've got these two latent mixtures
I've said, right, this mixture here has got a mean that's lower than this one. This one's got a mean fixed at zero. This one's allowed to find itself just based around the data. They've got the same standard deviations. One's got more people in it than the other, but they've got the same standard deviation. I could tell the model, actually, what I'm expecting to find is a group with a standard deviation of zero, zero variance. All of a sudden, I've got a latent class, because that's just what a latent class is, in effect. It's something that we know the value of what people have, but they've all got the same value, and anything we observe differently is error. So I've just restricted, I've just told my model, make sure that thing's got zero variance, and all of a sudden, I've fitted a latent class and a factor model to the same sort of data. There's a different way of conceptualizing that sort of thing. Say, for instance, I wanted to fit a latent profile model, and so this idea is that I fit my classes, and then everything else within the class has zero correlations. It's quite a strong assumption to make. There's always things correlating with other things in our sort of model. Sometimes you might get questionnaires that are always all phrased in the same way. Questions, you know, asking people things in the same way might lead to spurious, sort of uninteresting correlations. What I can do is take a latent profile model here, or two latent classes, and fit a factor model within each class. That then, if you like, flattens the circle. It's no longer the case that there's no correlations among things. But here we've definitely allowed for a correlation among the indicators in these classes. And so we've perhaps, in a principled way, dealt with some of the threats to this conditional independence assumption within classes. A couple of examples to give it a bit of reality. Earlier, we had perhaps two latent classes of political persuasion, political liking, left and right sort of dimension. Well, so there, we have to assume that we had completely, you know, fixed latent classes. You're either left wing or right wing. This one assumes that you can be more or less left wing or right wing, but it doesn't make a naive assumption of normality. It says, well, actually, there's going to be a large block of people who are perhaps more or less left wing, large block of people who are more or less right wing. There's going to be some mixing between them, much more realistic, based around sort of theories of political persuasion. Here's a theory of latent mental health. So the idea is you've got a lot of people who just, you know, at the end you measure them on any sort of measure of distress, and there's a lot of people who just bump up a zero. You have a highly skewed distribution where people just say, no, I'm fine, I feel great. So I represent that as a latent class. We've got a lot of people who've got zero mental health problems. And then you might say there's a normal distribution of people in the rest of the population who have more or less greater mental health problems. And then there's a small lump at the top there of people who've got severe mental health problems. And again, these are sort of two somewhat distinct groups. There is a blurry line between people who are just normal but a bit miserable today versus people who are sort of on the road to having severe mental health difficulties. My final bit that I'll say is, okay, he's been banging on about this a little bit, you know, latent classes, mixtures, all that, who really cares? Well, I would suggest it's really rather important if we take our sort of blinkers off of looking at the world through old models that forced you to look in that way and think, well, actually, what am I interested in scientifically? I want to be able to represent my theories adequately and flexibly. I want to have, you know, there is something different between having a normally distributed trait and a highly skewed trait. Normal distributions assume lots of little things added together, whereas if you've got something that's extremely skewed, it might be lots of little things multiplying together, which might have big differences for the way in which you envisage how these things are generated. If you've got distinct classes, then that might imply that certain classes have got certain elements that others lack incompletely. And so that could give us insight into what the causes of these different distributions are. Policy. If you've got qualitatively different acculturation classes, there really are separate groups, then they might respond differently to different policy interventions. So a latent group analysis might imply something different from a latent dimensional one. The opposite in mental health, where it used to be that, you know, medics would just want to know, right, do I diagnose, do I not? If I, you know, I want to be able to make a decision about whether I give someone some pills or whether I send them home and say, stop to worry. I just want to say whether somebody's well or they're ill. It's now becoming appreciated that it's a dimension, that there's variation. And so there's a basis now for very successful mental health, what they call early intervention services, that identify people at high risk of severe mental illnesses. And without being too stigmatizing about it, try and go in and offer support for these groups to try and stop them making the transition into these sort of highly problematic groups. And those things wouldn't have made sense from a sort of clearly, right, you're well, you're ill sort of approach.
There's some texts if you want to learn more about this stuff. I've just given a really brief skirt over of these things. There's some software and some training courses you can download if you want to have a play at using these fairly straightforwardly. That's less straightforward, but there you go, if you've got access to Stata. And those are the references that I talked about.